What we see is the politics of climate change for particular events. And of course, it is not, we don't have really a national policy yet. We have a California policy, a Texas policy, a New York policy. We, of course, have a German policy, a British policy, a Chinese policy. We don't have a coherent policy either nationally or globally. And unfortunately, the reality is that it is unlikely that there will be a successor to Kyoto. That, in fact, the politics of Kyoto have now gotten so vexed that it's unlikely that even with McCain and Obama, either one in the White House, pro-climate change, it is unlikely that we are going to achieve a successor agreement. And so the question will really become one of U.S. leadership. Will we do the right thing here in the United States? And I'll come back to that. Now, there's some big surprises that could lurk out there. I'm not going to spend much time on that. Basically, perhaps we're all wrong about climate change and, you know, the carbon issue is not an issue. Maybe there's some clean, big surprise out there that, you know, Steve, but I don't think so. And maybe a dramatic revival in nuclear power. But even if that were to happen, we can't build the plants fast enough, as much as I'm in favor of it. So we have some big surprises that we might have to deal with. So where are we headed? First of all, there's no real consensus on the reality and the need to act. No policy consensus yet. And I think the likelihood of an international agreement is actually declining. And that's really unfortunate. Maybe, you know, if Obama gets elected, we'll appoint Al Gore as our ambassador for climate change, and he'll help drive things around the world. That would be a good thing. But having said that, the problem is very simple. China, India, and the developing world have a much more difficult challenge than we do. And their problem is, how are they going to adopt regulations and policies that enable them to take on the new technology, which are moving relatively slow. Right now, we're going to see continued growth in greenhouse gases because the carbon caps aren't capping carbon, in fact. They're not stopping the carbon caps. We're finding all kinds of ways to evade them. We're buying our way out, but we're not actually reducing carbon. In fact, many of the green development mechanisms are net negative around the world. We're destroying rainforests in Indonesia to produce palm oil for eating. Doesn't make any sense. So we are going to see much more climate change. It is going to happen. Where should we be headed? We need to accelerate the technologies dramatically. We need to take seriously that climate change is a present problem, not a long-term problem. That we need a much stronger policy consensus. We need much more rapid implementation of the new energy technologies. We need to decouple greenhouse gases from economic growth. And that's crucial. Because we're going to continue to grow. So the question is, how can we reduce greenhouse gases while we do that? And if we do that, we might slow climate change. So what do we do? Well, first of all, we need better science in climate change. Because the truth is, the models are not very good. The science is not perfect by any means. And it's an extremely complex system and very unpredictable. We don't really know what the next move is. I mean, for example, there are hints that we might see in the next 3 or 4 years, a cooler world. Imagine it's 2012 and you're in the middle of negotiations on the successor to Kyoto, and people say, hey, the world's gotten cooler for the last 3 or 4 years. What are you worried about? And that's a very plausible scenario for 2012. Obviously, we need to continue to improve the policy or the technologies. We need to move aggressively toward all electric ground transport. I think we need very tough regulation, not just a carbon capture, I mean, a carbon capture trading system on greenhouse gas emissions. We do need a carbon pricing system, and we need a rapidly rising price of carbon. And in my view, the next great global institution, like the IMF and the World Trade Organization, that the world needs is a global EPA to achieve these agreements on a global scale. Because the environmental problem is no longer a national problem, it's no longer a local problem, it's a global problem. And it can't be solved by nations working one-on-one. They've got to collaborate. And so what we need is the U.S. taking leadership, helping to create a new wave of institutions that can create the kind of global agreements that are going to create the carbon pricing system and the regulations that are going to drive rapid technological change. And if we can do all of that, then there's a reasonable chance that the efforts that all of you are pursuing today will transform the world over the next half century. Thank you very much.